حياتي صارت ب 15 تشرين 1991 يوم الجمعة.
The calamity happened on Friday, November 15th, 1991. I was heading downtown. On the way there, I told my brother to return home. I was afraid for him, in case Israel bombed the area. On the previous day, many people from our town had taken shelter at night in our home. Something happened which made me feel afraid. As I was sleeping, someone accidentally spilled water over me. They told me spilled water was a bad omen. It meant a separation. I became worried, expecting something bad to happen to me. This is the place I'm most afraid of. I suddenly found myself lying on the ground, unable to stand up. My legs were blown off from above the knees. These artificial limbs are now a part of me. They're not my real legs, but they are my legs now. Sometimes I even talk to them. Our town was not occupied, but the Israelis used to enter it every day, bomb it and arrest people. I used to be very afraid when they shelled the town. When we walked to school, Israeli warplanes would open fire. I used to be very afraid of the place where I was hit, even before the incident. I don't know why. It was near the former Israeli military post of Blot. All the Israeli military positions overlooked our town, but I was especially afraid of that one.
The artillery bombardment targeted villages and towns along the front line, near the security zone. Any shelling carried out by the militiamen of Antoine Lehed on those villages had to be directly ordered by Israel. No Lehed militia commander could order an artillery strike. Only the Israelis could give the order for towns to be shelled. And when there was an attack on any of their positions, they would shell the entire area around that position. They also bombed resistance cells when they received information about their movements. They had heavy artillery equipment, 130mm cannons, 122mm mortars, 200mm and 155mm. I used to get frightened even though I held a position far from the operational center. I would take extra care when I moved from my home to the barracks or vice versa, or when I went into the field. I used to get really frightened. I didn't join the Lehed militia because of my beliefs or principles or out of any honorable humanitarian goal. I joined to earn a living and support my family and to pay my children's school fees. Maybe a mercenary fighter like us gets afraid, unlike resistant fighters who have a goal they may die for. The Lehed militiamen had nothing to die for. Once their posts were attacked, they would run away.
This oak tree has witnessed our secrets. We would sit under this tree and it provided us with shade. From here, I observed a house where we could rest. We stayed there, and the next day we carried out our mission. On that day, I passed close to my parents' home. There was maybe only 10 meters between me and my parents' house. But though I missed them a lot, I couldn't visit them. I didn't want to cause harm to either them or myself. All our homes were constantly monitored and our family members were harassed. They even used to take up rooftop positions on our homes to check if we would visit. What encouraged me to join the resistance and to follow the others was my family's presence there. My parents' home was still there, and they were living there. My parents were being harassed. Resistance was like a mission that I wanted to carry out in order to achieve liberation. I wanted to liberate my family and my people from this occupier. That's what encouraged me to join the resistance.
In 1989, when my brother-in-law was only 10 years old, Zalaht militiamen shot him in the yard. 3 months after that, they took two of my cousins and my sister-in-law to Al Khiam prison. My sister-in-law had an 11-month-old baby at that time. They returned the baby the next day. There was a great mourning in our home. All of us were screaming and crying when we saw the baby without his mother. It was very sad. The baby needed breastfeeding. I had a baby the same age, so as well as my own baby, I breastfed him too until his mother was freed from jail. There were few people in the town, only old people and children under the age of 15. Those who were above 15 had either been recruited or fled if they had the chance. Many youngsters ran away at night from our town. They didn't want to be recruited, just like my brother-in-law Muhammad. One day, they asked about him, but he managed to run away just like the others. We didn't see him again until Liberation Day.
My hometown is called Taiba in southern Lebanon. It was one of the occupied towns. I used to paint Taiba in grey without bright colours. It was engulfed in darkness because of the occupation, and that's why I used grey colours more than bright ones. I used to see a small ray of sunlight, and that's why I didn't draw a closed fence. I wanted to leave an opening, hoping for a bird to be set free from there. At that time, I imagined the colors in my hometown, but I never saw them. The town's soil was colored with the blood of our young resistance fighters who had died. Their souls were colored with righteousness, love, and beauty. But the dark and sad state of Tiber was without color. But then came liberation, and the same scene was lit up with color and brightness. When we arrived, it was very crowded. For the first time, all these people were happy with these crowds and queues for long hours. People were determined to enter the town despite fears of airstrikes from the helicopters hovering overhead. They were all determined to enter the town, even if they might die. That was the last promise they wanted to keep. I was afraid to step on the ground. It was so happy.
On the 21st of May 2000, I remember it was a Sunday, we reached this place at 2:30. We were traveling in around 10 cars. We wanted to enter our town. This area is called Qusair. The gate here used to separate the Israeli-occupied area from the free area. We started to negotiate with the UN as we wanted to enter Taiba. More people arrived in the area. The road was full of cars. People became more encouraged when they saw us gathering here. We reached the fortified gate, and the UN prevented us from entering. We said we wanted to enter our land, as we had been deprived from entering it for so long. We tried to force the gate open. The UN warned us against this, and we were making contacts. But we managed to break down the gate and enter. This is the Sal'a military post, the first position we reached after we had stormed the Deir Sirian gate. It was occupied by the Lahd militiamen. We thought we would see gunmen there, but they had run away. We went on to Deir Sirian.
Assalamu alaikum.
This was the second place we reached, Deir Sirian town, only 1 kilometer away from Taiba. We reached here and had the same problem. A UN gate separated Deir Sirian from Taiba. We told the UN that we wanted to enter Taiba, but they prevented us, and we had an argument. We suddenly heard on the news that Ehud Barak had threatened to bomb the UN gate between Deir Sirian and Taiba if they opened the road to Taiba. A few moments later, a group of cars arrived from Taiba. People wanted to meet and greet us, as they knew we had come from Deir Syrian. They received us warmly and invited us to go to Taiba. We arrived in Taiba Square. People were waiting for us there. It was a very joyful scene.
I looked around, so many people and my neighbors looking towards Deir Syrian. We felt extreme happiness. I threw sweets at people in the mosque and cheered happily. I was so happy and afraid these people would leave again. It was the best day ever, the day of May 21st.
We heard strange news that we could not believe, that a group of civilians from outside the security zone had stormed and occupied a military position in Taiba. The reports weren't about a military force occupying the post. We went to take pictures, as we weren't convinced about these reports of civilians taking over these positions.
It was Sunday afternoon. We went to Odese and they came from Makaba. The militiamen told us they had left their post after they had failed to receive any support. We arrived in Odese. Lahad militiamen had withdrawn from the Makaba post and arrived in Odese. They told us that they had left their post. The story of the liberation of southern Lebanon started on that day. The following day, people were surprised by the new situation on the ground. We were entering a new period after such a long time. People were confused.
For 2 days, we didn't realize what was going on. All we knew was that military positions were being overrun by civilians and that the Lahd militiamen were withdrawing. There was a state of fear and confusion, even among journalists. On the third day, we learned that the International Red Cross was going to transfer prisoners from Al Khiyam Detention Center to an unknown place. I went with my brother Lutfullah to Al Khiyam town. We saw the Red Cross there, and we also saw many people there, women, men, and children.
It was difficult to understand this new change in the situation back then. Suddenly, after 20 years, the country was liberated in a matter of seconds.
هذا الشتاء This rain, our freedom from this prison is like this rain. On May 23rd, 2000, we woke up in the morning to the sound of artillery shelling around the detention center. We thought it was another war. We waited until breakfast arrived at around 7:30 a.m. As we were eating, I noticed that all the investigation offices were closed. A collaborator who worked as a nurse in the detention center told someone that the south was being liberated. He said that the central region under the command of Ruben Aboud had already been liberated. But he knew nothing about al-Bahr, which is the Naqoura region. That person told me the news and I told the others.
At that time, the Lahad militia, known as the South Lebanon Army, which collaborated with Israel, sent heavy reinforcements to Al-Khiyam barracks. They sent troop carriers, soldiers, and individuals. We tried to negotiate with the Lahad militiamen. We tried to know what their demands were, especially since the Israeli army had already withdrawn. They refused to deal with us or talk with us. I went to the mosque downtown, over a kilometer away from here. It was difficult to get there as it was so crowded. I arrived at the Khiyam Mosque. Through the loudspeakers, I called on the collaborators to surrender.
We heard the call Allahu Akbar from the Khiyam Mosque. We heard people's voices near the detention center. At the same time, we heard gunfire within the detention center.
As a cameraman, I didn't understand what was going on. I couldn't believe if it was true. We wondered what was happening inside the detention center and if those people would free their prisoners. It was a difficult moment.
They asked us to open the road for them. We were not armed. They wanted us to leave the way open for them to escape before we freed the prisoners. They threatened to kill them if we didn't. So we opened the way for them and they fled. We threw stones at their cars. When they had left, we went up to the detention center.
We entered the detention center with all these people. I took pictures of them, breaking locks, smashing windows, and opening cell doors, freeing their detained relatives.
We used anything at hand to break open the doors. I used this iron rod. We wanted to release as many prisoners as we could. I broke open three doors with this iron rod.
Suddenly, the door flung open. I had told my cellmates to hide behind the door. We hid behind the door because I thought we were going to be executed. So if we hid behind the door, those opening it wouldn't see us. In a few seconds, the doors were opened and prisoners' families came in and freed us. We couldn't believe it because we could still hear the sound of Israeli shelling in the area. When I went outside, I saw a close friend of mine who had also been held prisoner. I embraced him. I didn't recognize anyone else. I ran to the main gate of the detention center and headed immediately towards the town of Al-Khiyam.
ونزلت دغري ضليت نازل صبل خيام. كان في مرأة اسمها أم عماد.
There was a woman named Imad. I'll never forget her. She was standing next to me. We saw her imprisoned son in the cell. She grabbed me and begged me to hurry because she wanted to free her imprisoned son. Her son stuck his fingers out from the little openings in his cell door and his mother was holding them just to touch him. I used all the strength I had to break the lock and open the door. She embraced her son.
In the field, we gathered our fighters in Tibnin, which was the last point in the liberated territories. After Tibnin comes Beit Tahawun, where the Lahad militiamen were positioned. We started to communicate with all resistance cells here and even with our families. The endurance of our families was a form of resistance. We observed the withdrawal of the Israeli occupation forces and the defeat of the collaborators. Collaborators started to give up their arms and surrender. We gathered in Tibnin on Monday morning, sent some groups in the evening to Beit Tahawun and Bint Jbeil. Though the Israelis were still stationed in Saf al-Hawa in post 17, our groups had already taken up positions inside the towns. At that time, I hadn't been in my home for over 16 years. It was a very touching moment. We entered Saf al-Hawa on Tuesday morning in public. Our groups were seen early Tuesday at 5 a.m. Our families gathered in Saf al-Hawa and welcomed us with joy. It was a very touching moment. Our families gathered there, chanted joyful songs and threw rice and roses. The first thing we did in Saf al-Hawa was to kiss the ground. Our families welcomed us as heroes. During those first moments, we couldn't even get to our homes. I immediately went to the town's cemetery to visit my father's grave. When my father died, I hadn't been able to attend his funeral or burial, and I didn't even know where his grave was. I then met my resistant comrades. We didn't have time to go to our homes because we had to immediately begin arresting all the collaborators who were surrendering to us.
I was in the barracks. Our commander didn't come. I called him, but his phone was switched off. I called his home phone, but no one answered. I phoned his family, no one answered. I called a friend of mine, and he told me they had fled to Israel. Because the Israelis had withdrawn from their posts. I was shocked. I didn't know what to do. I took my weapon, got in my car. I talked to no one, not even my friends, and I fled. I thought about no one but myself and my family. Here, we see the towns that were occupied. Der Mimas, Farkela, Burj al-Muluk, El Klea, El Khiam, Marjayun, Blat, and Dibin. We were very worried and terrified. During the liberation process, most of the militiamen didn't know the Israeli army had left the area. High-ranking commanders from Lahad's militia fled with their families. Some militiamen even took tanks and troop carriers and went to their homes, abandoning their posts to follow those who had fled to Israel. It used to take 15 minutes to drive from the barracks to my home. But on that day, it only took me 10 minutes, and yet it felt like a week. I just wanted to reach home, take my children, and escape. I arrived home. I found my wife crying as she hadn't known anything about me. She was afraid I was dead or that something bad had happened to me. I told her to grab whatever clothes we could wear and get into the car. I took my wife and children, but forgot my father and mother. I arrived at the Fatma gate, thinking it would be open and that we could enter Israel without a problem. I saw thousands of people gathering there, and the gate was closed. The Israeli army prevented anyone from entering. There were old people, women, children screaming, crying, and banging on the gate trying to enter. When they tried to break down the gate, an Israeli soldier shot at these people. A girl fell to the ground injured. They had to open the gate to take the wounded girl to a hospital, but she died later on. At that point, everyone entered through the gate. The main reason we fled to Israel was because of Sayyid Hassan Nasrallah's speech before the liberation. His speech had terrified everyone.
ولا أي موقع سياسي أو طائفي أو ديني مهما ارتفع صوته لن يستطيع أحد أن يحمي هؤلاء العملاء من قبضة المقاومين. لن يستطيع أحد.
خفنا. We were terrified. We could hardly stand on our own 2 feet with all the support from Israel that we had. So how could we stand on our own in the face of the resistance which had threatened to kill us? That was the main reason for our escape to Israel. Antoine Lahad was not in Lebanon at this time. He was visiting his children in France. He came on Liberation Day. He came when he learned that Israel had withdrawn from the western sector, from the town of Bint Jbeil. He was surprised. He didn't know what was going on. He arrived at the Fatma gate. Many people had gathered there, and he met many of his officers. He was in an embarrassing situation. All this was happening, and he was the leader of the militia, but he had no answers to any of his men's questions. He was as shocked with the new situation as we were. He got in his car, left for Tel Aviv, and he is still there.
We've been living here near Fatma Gate since 1953. Life was normal back then. This line didn't exist before. The borders were open. This gate and this barrier were built in 1970. They named it Fatma Gate. They locked the gates on the eve of May 24th, at midnight, after the last soldier entered Israel. We woke up on Wednesday, May 24th, to find there were no Israeli soldiers in Lebanon. People started to celebrate the liberation of South Lebanon. The most exciting moment was when cars crossed Khardala Bridge. That used to be a checkpoint crossing. Yet now they freely enter Kfar Kila, celebrating. We felt relaxed. No more restrictions. They used to close the crossing at 3 o'clock and prevent anyone from entering. People were very upset. Now, we are free to come from Beirut at 1 or 2 o'clock after midnight, and no one stops us. Now, I can walk on this pavement whenever I want. We feel safe in the presence of the army and the resistance. My home is only 50 meters away from Fatma Gate, and we're living.
May 25th was a good day, a historic day. The roads were opened and people were reunited. In our home, we used to be a small and happy family. But then we were separated. My brother escaped. All the neighbors fled. People were warning each other and urging each other to escape to Israel. He's been there now for 10 years. I hope the state and the humanitarian organizations will look into the cases of all those people who fled and who've not been able to come back. To help them come back to their towns and homes. Nowhere is safer than your own home. It was a difficult moment when my brother left. I wait for him every day. I wait for his family. It's nice to have a family.
especially when everyone is together. When he comes back, I'll set the table. We'll all sit together with him, his wife and children. I'll serve him food and he'll eat.
Thank God we are free from the occupation and we are happily reunited in the same house. We are very happy after having lived years of oppression and injustice. Thank God we are all together again and my children can meet their relatives, uncles and cousins. I hope to stay like this. I hope those days never come back.
I stayed in Israel for about a year and a half. I knew that resistance fighters were not arresting any of the Lahed militiamen. It was all handed by the state and the military court. So I preferred to return, to be prosecuted and jailed in my country, and to bear the responsibility for what they had done.
I never fell asleep when South Lebanon was occupied by Israel. I used to take sleeping pills and injections, but was never able to sleep. I slept very well after South Lebanon was liberated. During the liberation, I went out with my brother, and we watched the Israelis evacuating their positions. This is the only thing I did. I was very happy. I couldn't believe that we could enter these positions, which we couldn't even approach before. This is what I liked the most.
عشر سنين على التحرير تمر إحد موقع بلاط تستعيد الذكريات تسألي نفسك السؤال مين انتصر أنت ولا المدفع؟
أنا اللي انتصرت لا مش المدفع.
I won, not the cannon.
لأنه هو راح خلص.
Because it's gone, but I'm still here.
يعني هو فكر اللي عمل.
Those who shot me have gained nothing. But I'm still alive. They were defeated, but we're still on our land.